and still is badly misunderstood, although less so than it was 20 years ago when the test first came into general use by therapists. I would like another crack at correcting the misapprehensions. The test itself was described by Sharp and Purser in 1961 in a 30 or 40 page article on spontaneous dislocation of the AA segment by rheumatoid arthritis. It was validated by Utlicht and Inderbom in 1988, so it has 60 plus years of existence, during which time it has been terribly mauled by people who have obviously never read the original paper. And in that number, I'm sorry to say, I am included. It was, I have to say, in my defence, not easy to find the article, and even today, with Google in top gear, you will not have much luck. Especially if you type in Sharp Purser test, it is better to use the article's title. I have included a link for the full text article in the supplementary materials. This webinar will concern itself with the test procedure and true positives, not the mistaken ones that result in it being a transverse ligament integrity test, a clunk test, or a symptom reduction test. It will also look at the validation study of this test and some criticisms of the test made by myself and others regarding the most common misunderstanding of the test, symptom reduction. So on we go with the Sharp Purser test for anterior adlanto instability. A very quick review of the anatomy is in order. The AA segment is stabilized anteriorly, mainly by the transverse band of the cruciform ligament holding the dens against the posterior aspect of the arch of Atlas. It is prevented from jiggling in there by the tubercles, making the surfaces very congruent, and then the articular cartilage on both surfaces, the arch of Atlas and the transverse ligament, filling up the spaces. The stability is reinforced by the vertical band of the cruciform ligament and the merging of the dura and posterior longitudinal ligament as a tectorial membrane. But these are less important factors. The stability allows the segment to flex and not migrate anteriorly, which is what happens with an anterior instability. The X-ray shows the cervical spine and more particularly the AA segment in neutral. The segment is unstable, but looks fine in neutral. The anterior arch of Atlas is against the dens, but not in this case by healthy tissues, but by gravity. The system can be destabilized by a fracture of the arch or the dens or a Vulcan fracture of the ligament, more commonly and more occultly by softening of and erosion of the articular cartilage, the ligament or the bones by diseases such as systemic arthritis and Grisel's disease, and in very, very rare cases by rupture of the substance of the ligament caused by trauma. This is the same neck in flexion. The weight of the head via gravity now pulls the arch forwards, leaving a gap between it and the anterior aspect of the dens. The X-ray, of course, doesn't demonstrate which aspect of the system is affected. It may be one or all of them, but this is left to further imaging and other investigations. The distance between the dens and the arch of Atlas is called the atlantodental interval, or ADI. And it really should not exist when the system is healthy, even though some say that 3 millimeters of separation is normal. In fact, anything over 3 millimeters is considered unstable, and this is when surgery is starting to be considered. While it is likely that less than 3 millimeters may simply be normal degeneration, it really shouldn't be called normal. If sufficient migration of the atlas occurs, the spinal cord can be pulled far enough forward that it starts to become squeezed between the dens and the arch, leading to a central neurological signs of varying degrees, depending on how large the ADI is and how narrow the central canal is. In normal sized canals, this is about 8 millimeters, and it is possible to have a complete occlusion of the canal without dramatic effects occurring. The spine is actually pretty good at withstanding gradually increasing pressures. I have a kinetic X-ray video of the atlas moving forwards and backwards, completely occluding the canal in both directions, and an inset video of the patient happily flexing and extending. What I want you to remember from this slide is the 8 millimeter threshold for core compression. It will be important when we discuss the Sharp Purser test in terms of symptom reduction. I am reading this directly from the Sharp and Purser paper, so there can be no quibble about me misquoting it. I quote, "The palm of one hand was placed on the patient's forehead and the thumb of the other on the tip of the spinous process of the axis. The patient was asked to relax a neck in a semi-flexed position. By pressing backwards with the palm, a sliding movement of the head backwards in relation to the spine of the axis could be demonstrated. In this case, and I unquote now, in this case, a positive is a feeling of translation. With one exception, the validating study of Utrecht and Vinderboom, the test was done in the same manner, the exception being that instead of using the thumb to stabilize the axis, they used the index finger. This is one of the few pictures I've seen where the test is done as described by Sharp and Purser. I doubt that it makes any difference which digit you use, but I have seen it done stabilizing with the web between finger and thumb, and a false positive results that becomes negative when corrected. There is too much give in the web. I've also seen positives on courses when the atlanto-occipital joint isn't fully flexed as posterior gliding occurs. This doesn't seem to make too much difference on the validating study, but if I'm getting this in courses, there's no reason not to expect it to be occurring in practice. You don't have to force a head into flexion, but just make sure there isn't any real posterior translation of the AO joint. The test has been shown to be valid for ADIs of 3 millimeters and very valid for 4 millimeters and up, and we'll come back to these numbers later. As stated, the test was validated by Gregory Utvlicht, I'm sure I pronounced that wrong, and Samuel Indenbaum in 1988, using 123 consecutive rheumatoid patients. 26% were found to have an ADI of 3 millimeters or greater, and 21% were found to have a positive Sharp-Purser test. Of the 32 patients with instability demonstrated on radiograph, only 2, or 6% of the total, had neurological long tract signs, and both of these had positive Sharp-Purser tests. Of 25 patients with radiographic instability of 4 millimeters or more, 22 had positive Sharp-Purser tests, given a sensitivity rate of 88% and a false negative rate of 96%. This gives a positive likelihood ratio of 22 and a negative ratio of 0.125. The former is obviously the more useful of the numbers. This comes up on classes often where positives are found all the time. So let's see if we can put some numbers to this and make it a bit more concrete. In a class, a student tests positive. We need to look at the pre-test probability that he or she has rheumatoid arthritis or another collagenous disease. Let's take the high end of the RA prevalence rate for North America, which is about 1% or 0.1. And multiply it by the likelihood ratio of 22, and we get a post-head likelihood ratio of 0.22, or a probability of 0.71%. This is extremely small and likely a tester error, but still enough of a worry. But if a student has no evidence of RA or any other condition that may indicate that an instability might be present, that is no history or signs of symptoms, then the pretest probably must be much shorter. Let's say it's only 0.01, and this is probably very low for somebody who doesn't have any other symptoms. Then the post-test probably will fall to 0.18%. That is 1/5 of 1%. Which is more likely, a true instability or a screwed up test? Now, let's look at the test from the perspective of a positive being symptom reduction. In this version, the patient flexes their head and experiences spinal cord symptoms, usually described as bilateral or quadrilateral paresthesia. The test is carried out as previously described, and if the symptoms are reduced or eliminated, the test is considered positive, and cord compression from anterior instability of the AA segment is provisionally diagnosed. I still have problems with how this approach was so popular for so long and how it is still being used today. I wrote an article for Journal of Manual Manipulative Therapy in 1998 entitled "The Sharp-Purser Test, a Useful Clinical Tool or an Exercise in Futility and Risk." The article is in the supplemental materials. First, I pointed out that if somebody experienced spinal cord or brainstem symptoms on neck flexion, they should be immediately put into a collar and transferred by ambulance to an emergency room, not dicked about by a therapist as they try to figure out where the axis spinous process was in the panic that was engendered by the patient telling that they were tingling everywhere. Second, if the test is positive Or if it is negative, you would do exactly the same thing of a patient who complains of spinal cord symptoms. Get them to the ER. So why bother with the tests? There are better ways of finding what is compressing the cord. And of course, the issue may be more critical than instability or a disc extrusion. The symptoms may, for example, be caused by a destabilized Chiari malformation. Less vital, but more technical, is the fact that given that it takes about 8 millimeters of migration to begin to compress a cord in the normal neck and so get symptoms, and only about 4 millimeters, and in some cases 3, to detect the instability with a proper Sharpe-Hirse test, this is much more sensitive to minor degrees of instability than is a symptom reduction version. The clunk test is marginally worse or better, in my view, worse. Here, what you do is the same test, but you repeatedly try to bring the to bang the arch of the atlas against the den so you can hear a nice clunk. I have no idea who came up with this butte, but there was and still is a faction that argues that the test is only valid in patients with rheumatoid arthritis and ankylosing spondylitis, as these were the population for which the test was designed. But this is logically incorrect, not to say absurd. It is not the original article that would determine the population, but the validating study in which was carried out on rheumatoid patients. In either case, the argument is patently silly. Instability is instability regardless of what caused it, and a test that works will work on the instability regardless of its cause. It is like arguing that a valgus stress test of the knee will only be positive if the valgus instability is caused by trauma. It's ridiculous. My feeling is that the test should be done routinely to screen for instability before any treatment that will move the neck is carried out, especially if the treatment is going to be mobilization or manipulation. This said, providing that there are no contraindications, and these will be discussed on the next slide. So, when shouldn't you use a test? Upper cervical fractures, obviously. The dens is fractured, you're not going to do the patients any favours by messing around in this area. So a sudden onset of severest post-traumatic pain, post-traumatic torticollis, significant range of motion loss, etc. We've covered this in previous webinars. Two, any central signs and symptoms indicate that something should not be messed with in the clinic, regardless of how safe you think the test may or may not be in that case. For example, a brainstem concussion injury will not be adversely affected by the test, but why mess with it? You already have enough information to fire it out of your clinic. Third, when the patient does not want to move his head or neck, don't make them. See number one. Dizziness, but not just dizziness. Dizziness associated with neurological signs, or more likely with a headache, posterior headache in particular. This would indicate a vertebral artery issue. And while you may not do this any damage, you shouldn't be moving the neck around with this patient. When you feel uncomfortable about doing the test for any or no apparent reason, it's always a good reason to send for a second opinion. Follow your gut a little bit. We might as well look at the chief competitor to the Sharpe-Hirse, the so-called transverse ligament stress test. This is a test that was most widely used up until 20 years ago when the Sharpe-Hirse test became more popular. But it still may maintain that most used status for all I know. The patient is laid supine, the therapist holds the head with the index fingers overlying, or is it underlying, the posterior arch of the atlas, and lifts it straight anteriorly upwards without extension occurring. A variation is to stabilize the axis anteriorly with the thumbs, but this is a bit brutal and can result in the patient tensing and nullifying the test. A positive test is where central signs and symptoms occur, or in very few cases, the tester is sensitive and skilled enough that he feels an anterior shift. But this is extremely difficult to feel as the entire neck moves forwards, and determining what is general and what is specific movement is, to say the least, difficult. I have no idea of how good this test is, as no validation studies have been carried out on it, but I can say with some certainty that if symptoms are sought, then it has the same sensitivity issues as does the symptom reduction version of the Sharpe-Hirse test. Nothing wrong with it, I don't think. It's just that you don't have any numbers for it. So, in conclusion, I think we can say that the Sharp Person test is validated and useful when it is done and interpreted correctly, and when done in the absence of contraindications. The clunk test, transverse ligament stress test, symptom reduction versions have no validating numbers associated with them and may pose a greater risk than the Sharp Purser. In any case, we have a test with established credentials that show it to be efficient and effective, and that is easy to apply. Why use anything else? Thank you for watching this, and as always, your comments are appreciated and will be responded to, and we'll talk again in a week or so. Bye-bye.